brought to you by Puffin.
Greta and the Ghost Hunters by Sam Copeland. Read by James Faulkner. Prologue. Greta Woebegone did not believe in ghosts because she was a sensible young girl, and sensible young girls tend not to believe in ghosts. That was until the day she was knocked over by a car and died, when everything changed. But do not be too alarmed. Greta Woebegone did not die for long. You see, the thing about Greta is that she is surprisingly indestructible. And a Volkswagen Passat proved to be no match for her. But we shall not be starting our story at the scene of an automobile accident. That would be far too dramatic, and this is not that type of book. This is a very serious novel full of important themes and valuable moral lessons, and not one of easy thrills and cheap laughs. Instead, we shall begin by introducing the characters and build up to the little car incident, as it became known in the Woebegone household. So, who belongs to this Woebegone household? Excellent question. You've already met Greta Woebegone. She is 10 years old, small, and unimportant looking. Beyond that, well, I'm not sure what to say about her. You children all look the same to me. She is, though, the main character of this book, unfortunately. And why, unfortunately? Because Greta Woebegone is rather dull.
No, I'm not,
Greta might argue, if it was her turn to talk, which it isn't.
I'm actually rather interesting. I have brown hair, I love dogs and football. My favourite subject is...
Stop interrupting, Greta. Wait your turn. Greta lives in Woebegone Hall, a grand name for not such a grand house. The name was given to it by Greta's great-great-great-great-grandfather, a man high of aspiration and low of wealth. Woebegone Hall is a tall tombstone of a building, a great weathered slab of grey stone, peppered with cobwebbed windows. It has 4 bedrooms, and Greta's bedroom looks out over the small back garden, the graveyard beyond, where many of the Woebegone family are buried, and on to the factories in the distance. Greta's brother, even more small and insignificant than his sister, has the bedroom next to hers. He's 3 years old. I cannot at this moment recall his name. If it were his turn to speak, he would probably say something about lorries or some such. I don't really know. I try not to listen to him. Greta is fortunate enough to still have both her parents. Her father, William Woebegone, uses a wheelchair, smokes a pipe, and has a large beard and moustache, and is always working on his latest collection of poetry. Her mother, Prozeka, also smokes a pipe, but has neither beard nor moustache. She does have dyed purple hair, however, and loves yoga, crystals, and chanting. And whenever Prozeka chants, William closes his eyes and furrows his brow as if in great pain. That leaves Mildred Woebegone, or Grandma Woebegone, as she is more commonly known, both ancient family matriarch and Greta's best friend. Grandma Woebegone lives in the attic, because that is where old women live in stories, even though it is extremely impractical and dangerous to give them rooms at the top of so many rickety stairs. She has a world-record-sized marble collection and many, many years ago was a racing driver, and a very good one too. She was all set to race in the World Championship before an accident destroyed her car and left her with a broken arm, and her husband, George Woebegone, made her stop, which was something that husbands could do to their wives in those days. Grandma Woebegone's bedroom is dotted with black and white photographs of her standing next to her racing car, shaking bottles of champagne, laurel wreaths around her neck, and several old trophies that gather dust on her shelf. Grandma Woebegone is also convinced she can speak to ghosts. This is nonsense. The rest of the family all know there is nothing haunted about their house. The strange chills they all feel from time to time are just drafts. The weird clunks and creaks that rattle the house at night are just pipes. The creeping sense of dread that shivers up their necks whenever they go into the cellar is just rising damp. And the awful smells that occasionally fill the house are merely coming from the nappy of Greta's little brother. This is true. Those nappies are undeniably dreadful. Finally, there is a cowardly ginger cat called Pussylanimous. When not hiding under a bed or in wardrobes, it wheezes on the rugs and fails to catch the mice that scuttle around the house whenever the lights go out, which they regularly do. And that is everybody you need to know about right now. Well, not quite everybody. So who am I? That is the question. But one that will be answered later. For now, I shall retreat into the background and allow this little story to unfold. We begin on a biting grey morning, deep in the cold heart of November, as Greta Woebegone makes her entrance. Chapter 1. Greta Woebegone ran up the stairs of Woebegone Hall, two at a time. It still took her quite a while to reach the top because there were a lot of them. She burst into the attic, and there was Grandma Woebegone, sitting in the bed she rarely had the strength to leave, wearing a lacy nightie and round purple sunglasses, which helped her see the spirits.
"Quietly, dear. You startled Grandpa," Grandma Woebegone whispered, pointing to an empty space next to the bed. "Hi, Grandpa," Greta waved to the empty space next to the bed. "How are you today?"
Greta had no memory of her grandfather, who had died not long after she was born. Grandma Woebegone cocked her bespectacled head towards the empty space, listening hard.
"He says he's very well, thank you. He says he'd love to hear you play the recorder later."
This ought to have been a giveaway that Grandma could not, in fact, talk to ghosts. No adult, living or dead, ever truly wants to listen to a child play the recorder.
"And,"
Grandma Woebegone continued, a smile wrinkling her face as she pulled out a small parcel from under her pillow,
"he says, happy birthday." "Thanks, Grandpa," Greta beamed. "And thank you, Grandma."
Greta took the present and gave her grandma a warm hug. Grandma Woebegone grinned.
"Well, go on, then. Open it."
Greta tore at the wrapping paper, and three presents fell into her lap. They were a half-used roll of sellotape, a tin of kidney beans, and a calendar entitled The World's Most Spectacular Wheelbarrows. Greta did her best to push a grateful smile onto her face.
"Lovely," she said. "I mean, great, but... why did..."
Grandma gave her a knowing wink.
"Grandpa told me you like wheelbarrows at the moment. Did he now? Thanks, Grandpa."
Greta gave two thumbs up to the empty space next to the bed.
"He says you're very welcome," Grandma said, patting Greta's leg. "And the sellotape is to stick the pictures of the wheelbarrows up when the calendar is finished."
"Of course," said Greta, nodding. "So thoughtful. And yum. Kidney beans, too. You shouldn't have, Grandma. Really."
"Your favourite." "My favourite."
They were not Greta's favourite. In fact, anybody who says kidney beans are their favourites are enormous liars who probably secretly snaffle whole chocolate eggs when they think nobody is looking. It was doubly unfortunate that not only were the kidney beans and sellotape terrible presents, they were also the cause of Greta's death. The world's most spectacular wheelbarrows were not to blame.
"Thanks for all my presents, Grandma. They're brilliant,"
White lied Greta, giving her grandmother another hug.
"Bye for now, and bye, Grandpa."
Greta waved again at the empty space and clutching her presents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.